class where you get to take out your smartphones. So if you, this is the class where you get to take out your smartphones. Text AirChat one word, doesn't matter if it's upper or lowercase, to that phone number, that 5-digit phone number. And that'll just get you into the poll and then just have your phone ready.
Wait. Take a day and a half. 12 hours we have required, you know?
So this presentation is a lot of demos, so you want to be able to see the screen really well.
Please don't sit in the back of the classroom.
Or on the far side. On the far side is my plan is going to be.
We are educators, right? We are professors.
But a lot of the time we feel like just very busy administrators, and the administrative duties we have can be overwhelming. So what we here decided is we want to get as much efficiency as possible out of data management, and that means online tools. But to focus in on where we are today, what kind of pressures we're feeling, insufficient too, administrative support. As you saw from the previous slide, for my only administrative support, I have a share of a legal assistant. I share her with 9 other professors. That's my admin support. And tight budgets. We're not all knocking down our dean's doors asking for more money, or if we are, the door is staying shut. Other demands on faculty time. Many of us work externships and other programs or other courses, or even within externships, we're just being asked to do more and more. Then there's keeping track of everything. I was speaking with someone who's in our conference, which is a legal writing professor, and she sat in on the session with the ADA guy and said, I had no idea there were that many regulations. So keeping up with things like, let's get these 3-party written agreements, written or signed, I don't know, and keep track of them. All the agreements that keep track of other things. And then on top of that, a lot of us are experiencing growing programs. Our schools now, if they weren't already, have to provide 6 units of experiential learning. Some of that is going from externships, so we've got more students coming to you. I'm in a school that allows paid positions now, and my numbers went up by about 40% instantly. So how am I keeping track of my additional 30 and 40 more students? So that's where the data management comes in.
All right, so I think we're each gonna cover what goes into our thought process when we select the various programs that we use to administer our externship administration. But as an overview, some of the things that I know that we've all considered and things that you should consider when you're looking at maybe switching or incorporating something new, first and foremost is budget. And I think that's a lot of diversity that we bring on the panel. We have everything from free all the way up to kind of the Cadillac model that does most of what you need it to do. I, for one, I'm gonna cover Dropbox. I kind of had to band-aid it a little bit. When I took over our externship program, students were just emailing every week their timesheets and their journals, and I about pulled my hair out trying to keep up with my inbox. So, and I'll talk about that a little bit more in a second. Size of the program. This can be a little bit counterintuitive sometimes. You know, the bigger the program, oftentimes the more the resources, and yes, you also need more support, but then in some ways, the smaller the program, I don't have any help, so I need as much support from a, you know, program management standpoint. Learning curve and training and support. This is also something that, you know, I had to make a switch pretty quickly, and so I didn't have a lot of time to put in resources to put into my learning curve. But then in addition to that, are you going to be having other faculty members utilizing this? Are you going to need to train your students on a platform? And your supervisors, are they going to have access to it? Are you going to have to provide training for them? So it's not just your learning curve, but if you're going to use it for an all-encompassing purpose, you need to be able to teach and train others. And so then what also goes into that is how much support is offered by the program itself. I use Dropbox. I also piggyback with Simplicity with our Career Services office. So obviously we have some support with Simplicity. Dropbox, I just figured out on the fly. That's pretty intuitive anyway. Record retention considerations, this is another big one. And especially now that we may or may not have paper copies, which absolutely blew my mind yesterday. That was not something I'd even interpreted from the rules. I took that our online records were appropriate. And then accessibility of records. And again, that goes back to who all has access to what lives on the platform or in the cloud that we utilize. Okay, so I use Dropbox. Again, you know, this was a kind of make or break moment for me. I had to figure out something very quickly.
When I took over my program, I also, within the first semester, I lost my assistant. And I have an assistant, I only had her about half-time anyway, but I could not keep up with students emailing. It was not an efficient use of my time. The moment that they would email me their documents, then the next week or two would roll, and I'd be just saving over what they had just sent me. And so when I had a break in semesters, I quickly needed to figure out something else to work for timesheets and guided reflection questions in particular. And a little bit of backstory here as well. Our clinic had recently incorporated Clio, and I did a little bit of training with that, and I saw that that could be utilized in my externship program using students instead of cases for the files, and then they could spend their time that way. What I ran into with that, though, was that as an administrator for Clio, I then had access to all of the clinic files, which I couldn't have since I'm not an in-house attorney with them. And then the contract with Clio for our free account was signed across campus. And so then I got caught in a lot of red tape if we were going to do a secondary account, if that was even allowed, and I had to go across campus to get the agreement taken care of. And so, again, I just got caught in all the red tape, and I needed to make a change, and that was not happening as quickly as I needed it to. But that is something that you might look at or consider if you have time or can work through that, or if you don't have to work through any of that. I definitely see some use in the externship program from that, at least from a preliminary perspective. So I ended up just deciding on Dropbox. It's something that my students already know. My supervisors, they don't have access to it, so it doesn't matter, but my my faculty, it's intuitive and it's easy. I did shell out the expense of $100 a year, which considering I don't have a huge budget, it didn't take a lot to think about. It was definitely worth it, but I needed the bigger space to house all the documents than what the free account could provide. But it's definitely been worth it. So let's see, I'm gonna walk you through what mine actually looks like so you can see how I have it set up. So I have three classes. I have a civil class, a criminal class, and a judicial class. I actually have student permission. I'm gonna go in and show you kind of what one of hers looks like, but again, it's very intuitive. It took me a little bit to figure out that you can't share up in files. So like I'm the only one, and this is the way that mine's set up. I'm the only one that has access to what this looks like. But then I create a file for each student, and each student is on their own file along with the professor that teaches the course and me. And so Rila's giving me permission here. I have all their guided reflection questions, and then their hours and journals, and then they just update that per requirements. We do it every other week. This is great because you can go in, see where they are with their hours, and then we make comments over here if there's anything to discuss.
What was in that last right column?
What's that?
What was in that last right column?
So that's where we can make comments. This student had, and I was going through this last night, just kind of preparing this kind of for demonstration. But she had commented that something she never appreciated, and this was in her timesheet somewhere, was that a simple Google search is often more effective than Westlaw. And so I just I commented and said yes, and then she can comment back. And so we use that more so in guided reflection questions. Again, so if I have a follow-up question, then she can reply here, or if the faculty member wants to chime in. And that's how we do feedback on their guided reflection questions.
Lauren, since you create the folders, does that let you see everything the students post, or do they have to share documents once they post them?
No, so there are a few students that get a little bit caught up in that, like, do I have to share? But what happens is at the beginning of the semester, we create the folder for each student, and they're emailed a link to the folder, and they just upload the document into the folder. They don't have to share it. It all lives in their folder, and we can all see it.
The other students can see it too?
No. Only, only those on the members folder. So here is the student, me, and the professor. Same thing down here. You can see Chase, me, and the professor. So they basically have access to this folder, and then all questions on that piece of it, we go back to our slides.
Do your students have other places that upload things? Do you use Twin or anything else?
Yeah, so, and I'll segue into that a little bit. Well, I use Simplicity just for job postings, but they do not upload anywhere else. I give them an orientation. I give them an assignment that we review at midterm and at final to track their kind of professional development throughout their placement. And so that also lives in there, and that's easy for me to pull up when we're having our midterm meeting and our final meeting. But the downfall with Dropbox is that the files cannot live there forever. And so at the end of each semester, I have my my assistant go in, and she has kind of perfected it so she can at least do it by student. She can select all the documents and then pull them over to our secured server where they will live. So I have them for my record retention purposes. So, and then what I'm going to do is I'm going to, because I've only done this for about a year now, I'm going to keep them there for a year in case I need to access them or if a student needs to access them for any reason. And then I'll go through and delete their file. And then that'll keep enough space. Because the $100 a year does not provide me unlimited storage, but it provides me enough that I can keep a year or two's worth at a time. The other downside to this is I can't run reports from this, obviously. So a lot of the platforms you can see on average, you know, how many students are doing various things. I mean, I can't do any of that, so I have to go manage all of that on my own if I need to pull any information that way. Obviously, it doesn't track or help me actually place the students. This is purely for, you know, allowing students to help me with their record retention and submitting their documents. let's see. Any other questions on Dropbox? All right, so I'm going to segue into Sarah with Simplicity. I also use Simplicity, like I said, for job postings. We just closed our window on Tuesday, and I piggyback on that account with my career services office. That's not something that I use independently, but our students are already trained on it, so it does work well for that purpose.
So when I came to Emory, everything was on paper. Like literally, my predecessor was printing out weekly timesheets that she was receiving by email and printing them out and filing them in everyone's files. And we had like 80 or 90 different placements and 110 or 120 students each semester. Now our program is up to 150. I think we have 149 placements this semester. And 175 students in placements each semester. And so when I saw her filing everything, I was like, well, that's the first thing that's gonna change. So I asked around, I went to my IT department and I said, I wanna create, you know, this database that's gonna do all these things. And our IT director said, that's awesome that you wanna do that. I don't have the resources to create that for you. So I looked around, and Simplicity was already used by our career services department. Because it was already being used by them, it was already being paid for by them. And so they have a free external or experiential learning module that if your school is already using Simplicity, you just have to get them to turn it on. Unless something has changed, I mean, I don't think that they have made that something that they pay for. Upsides and downsides to that are that they also don't support it as much or build it out as much as maybe they should. And Simplicity, as my supervisors will tell me, is not simple. So, but ultimately, with all of its failings, because I found that 60% of our placements were already in Simplicity because they also are hiring our students in other ways, and our students are already trained on it. I will say, don't assume that supervisors are trained on it, because the people who do the hiring for internships are usually often HR professionals, but the people who are our supervisors for the externship program and who are making those decisions are often attorneys who are only going into it once every semester. And so you'll need to work with them, and they have to just go in and get on the phone and do things for them, rather than expect that they're going to spend a lot of time to be trained on how to use Simplicity. So in Simplicity, you can do everything that a career services office would do. So you can post positions, collect the resumes, you can have the resumes go out every time a student submits it, or you can have them collect resumes for like a week, and we're in the middle of our application period right now. It'll collect for a week, and then at the end of the posting period, automatically send out the resumes to all of the placements. You can generate resume books independently as well, and you can also schedule interviews. The way we have it set up is you do a non-OCR, non-on-campus interview resume collect, but then you can also separately use the on-campus interview module to set up interviews if you want to schedule interviews on campus. And that's nice because what you do is you set up a schedule, you send that out to students, and you say pick a time so that you don't have to do all this back and forth with students signing up four times. I only do that for our larger placements where there are a lot of applicants because there is a lot of administrative time spent in setting up those interview schedules. I recommend to our supervisors that if they're interviewing five or fewer students, it's going to be faster for them to just set up those interviews themselves. You can also, the big advantage is you can correspond with students and supervisors in bulk. So there's all kinds of emails, and you can select all the, you can do filters and select all the people that you want to send an email to and send it out. Again, you know, it gets a little tricky sometimes trying to figure out how many of the, you know, how those fields all work, but it is, it's great for, I use it all the time for communicating with my supervisors, which is one of those, you know, ABA 304 requirements. There's also announcements, so when the students log on to Simplicity, they will see announcements. If supervisors log on to Simplicity, they will see announcements. So you can use it as a place to post information that you don't, you know, if you, like, for Emory, they don't like us to post sort of up-to-date information on our website, you know. I mean, they don't like to change our website all the time, and so if you want to have, you know, changing information and have control over that information, you can post it in Simplicity. There's also very robust reporting, and so you can, everything from the job postings and receiving the resumes, see how many applicants they have, and all of that stuff. And then, that's just job postings. If you have the experiential learning module, then once you can actually have the supervisors put their offers into the experiential learning module, put the offers into Simplicity, it will hold the offers until you release them. That's actually not part of the experiential learning module, that's just the general package. But as soon as the student accepts it, it'll then create an experiential learning record. And that's, when you go forward, that's the list that we use to enroll students in the course. And then there are evaluations and self-evaluations and all kinds of pieces. They can have learning objectives. There are all kinds of reminders that you can send from that, and there is a way to do time records. Now, I will tell you that I don't use a lot of those functions because, as I mentioned, they're not built out as robustly as I would like them to be, but I use it for evaluations because you can send the supervisors a link. They don't even have to log in. They get a link. And you can send them a bulk email, they get the link, they fill out the form, they click submit, and they're done. So it's a very easy way to collect evaluations. Same things with the students. They also can do evaluations of the placement through Simplicity, yes.
When you say they click on the link and they fill out the form, the form's in a PDF, a fillable PDF, and they just do that,
it's in
signature?
It's in Simplicity, and hopefully can demonstrate it. I need to see if I have a student, somebody who's not a student, but it's just an online form, and when they click submit, it goes into Simplicity.
Did you build it, or was it already in the module?
Well, it's already there, but I control, you can change what the questions are. Simplicity is very custom, like you can change all of the form, you know, the fields and everything. It can be a little overwhelming, actually, but you can change almost any of the fields. You can change your non-OCR resume collect posting to collect whatever information you want. So there's a whole lot, and then you can report all that information. So there's a whole lot of information there. Yeah.
Your career services office see yes. the information?
And I can see the career services office information.
Because that's one issue we have. You don't do the student eval in there because it's a student educational record, and because of the privacy law, I don't know if that anybody else is concerned about that.
In my view, the career services office needs to see that information, that they are people who are helping to counsel our students. And so at least within our school, that's not something, I mean, yes, if people outside of the people who are counseling the student could see the information, I would be concerned. But I think this is stuff that our career services office needs to see. And I actually call them if the student's having a problem in an externship and say, how are we going to strategize about this, because it's going to affect their career going forward.
So when you send the evaluation is to the placement site supervisor, it's automatically linked back to that student?
Yes.
Or does the supervisor need to put in the student's information?
It's already linked back to the student. It's specific to the student. So why don't I go ahead and do a demonstration, and then we'll come back to the pros and cons. So this is on the application side. These are our current applications. You can see how many applications we have. I can show you what the applications list looks like. I'm not going to go in and show you individual students' materials. So this is the list of the students who have applied. You can change whatever materials you want them to submit. This is a cover letter, a resume, and a writing sample. And then eventually we will, once this position closes, you'll be able to post offers here. The student will be able to see the offer when they log in, and then they can accept the offer, but you can control all the offers on the back end over here.
And they only see themselves?
Yeah, they only see their, when they log in, and you can actually log in as a student or log in as a supervisor, like as a specific student. And so you could go in and do their stuff for them. So that's actually pretty handy because not all software systems allow you to do that kind of thing.
Do you do career professional development sign-off on resumes before they're sent?
No.
Really?
I think
we encourage.
We say if you can't post it to a posting until it's been reviewed.
We do that as well.
Okay, and that would be, since I'm not in the career services office, I don't know what their requirements are. I know that they have, I'm pretty sure it's optional resume review, but I've seen some resumes that probably could have benefited from review.
We do it as a second set of eyes, and I always give the career services office a heads up whenever, so my deadline was Tuesday, and mine looked just like this, that they're going to have an influx of documents coming into review.
Well, we do that for the regular posting, so it just made sense to do it for the internship.
But I leave it up to career whatever career services rules are, you know, if they have to do that before they upload a resume, but I don't review any of that. They apply, whatever it is, I don't have the time and resources to review all that. And it's also something I sort of view as a career services function. They should be talking with their career services advisor about all of these things, including all the externships they're applying to. So I hope that they're asking me about what's available as an externship and that sort of thing, but I also hope that they're talking to their career advisor about sort of generally planning out what their internships and externships should be and what their resume should look like. Yeah.
So when you say that the supervisor's offers or the employer's offers are reflected there, what does that mean?
They will be. So I think we have it, we're holding, it's either because the posting is not, because we're in the middle of the application period, it's either because the posting hasn't closed yet or because we have turned off a setting for now so that offers don't go out automatically, so that offers don't accidentally go out before it's time. And so over here on the right-hand side, there will be a button that says extend offer to student. If the supervisor signs into Simplicity, they also can see a list of all their applicants and they can do it themselves. And so what it does is it'll send an automatic email to the student, says you have an offer with this agency, and you know, please log into Simplicity to accept the offer. Also, if they log into Simplicity, then they'll see you have an offer, you know, click here to go and accept or decline your offer. And the other handy thing you can see here is you can actually see who's actually looking at the position, because they're a lot of them are looking at it and not interested in it, but so you can see a lot of students are taking a look at it.
Sarah, I like the student views tab. Sometimes a placement will say, why aren't I getting more applicants?
Right.
I'll say, 40 students have looked at this.
Right, but decided that they weren't eligible, or
maybe
decided
the
they weren't interested.
Isn't up. I don't know what they're waiting for, or is there some way we can tweak the description, or why?
Yeah.
My experience has been with Simplicity with placement site supervisors. They run the gamut from they are able to get in there, they use it, to others who don't. So for those that don't, do you go in and prompt the offer letters? Or how does that happen?
Yes, so we're trying to get offers any way we can. So if they don't want to log in, I have my program coordinator, she's sending emails reminding them, we need your offer, we need your offer. If they're having, and they say, it says, if you're having trouble, just call us. We get on the phone, and you can log in as the supervisor and just, you know, do it for them while you're on the phone. And sometimes they'll put in offers that you can also do rankings, by the way, so they can do alternates.
Like,
so they can do a first round offer and then have alternates, and it'll automatically move up the alternates if the first round offer declines. So you know, you can just sort of start it running and it goes, and it just automatically moves everybody up, and so they rank, you know, they can rank their first alternate, second alternate, and so forth. And so just depending on the sophistication of the supervisor, you know, you can do it for them if it's easier to just, a lot of times it's just easier to get on the phone and do it for them while you're talking on the phone with them. Yes?
I mean, we have a problem with people who work with job postings and extra trip postings at the same time. They got all mixed up.
That's a difficulty, and we are constantly negotiating with our career services office about how our emails can communicate that, and how we can keep those straight. And I just have to constantly remind them that we're the externship folks, and if you have an internship posting, you need to talk to Garnett Taylor. And yeah, that is a downside. And you know, we're going to have a lot of time towards the end to answer a lot of, well, we may not have a lot of time to answer questions. I wanted to show you the experiential learning piece. So so these are all our students for this semester. And so once they accept an offer, they get dropped into this, and they actually have an agreement that I require them to sign that says I'm committed to this externship and I understand I can't drop it. And so you can create that form. Let me see if I have a test.
Thank you.
Yeah, good. Okay, so this is a test position from spring. And supervisor named Dolly Parton. Let's see, we can log in as this student. And so you can actually see what this looks like. They can apply specifically to externships. This is what the postings look like on their end. And then when they go to externship info and agreements, so the student would go here and they have this basic information that they have to confirm, yes, I accepted the right offer, a bunch of information about what the courses are that they're signing up for, because we have multiple courses and sections, and so they have to tell us which course they want, the credit hours, and I agree to take this externship, and I know I can't drop it, and they provide us with their direct supervisor information, and then once they've done that, then we enroll them in the course. Then they have a program evaluation And you can decide what these questions are. So you can pick the questions, and these are the ones that I use, but you know, there's no magic to it. And we do ask, what would you like students who are considering applying to this placement to know? What advice would you give to the incoming extern? In other words, somebody who's already accepted the position, like where to park and stuff like that. And then comments that they want to give to me that they might not want to be public. And I don't publish these with names to the supervisors. And I don't publish individual evaluations to supervisors. I summarize the information and provide it to them, or I have a goal of providing it to them. Basically, I look at it to see if there's a problem and then call them up. But my goal is ultimately to, you can run a report on all this information and see sort of patterns of what's going on. And then, let me go back here. So if I were to log in as a student, back to my externship info and experiential learning. Okay, then I can also see my employer evaluation, and this we haven't submitted it, but this is the student can see their employer's evaluation. So if I were going to go on this side and look at, I'm looking at this from inside as a manager, and there's a, this is what the evaluation looks like from the supervisor's side. So they get a link, which you can see here, but it also can be sent out by email. And this is what it looks like on their end, and they fill this out. And at the end of the semester, I've got this split into midterm and final evaluations. There is a trick about how you can get both of those to work. And so email me if you want to do that, and I'll walk you through it. But there's a midterm and a final evaluation, and then once it's done, you click save, and it's submitted. And then thank you for submitting it, and then we have it on our end. So it's just really handy to have, and it, like as you see, it is connected to the student. You can also do a semester report. We don't require that. We do all of our academic requirements are in Canvas because we use Canvas for all of our courses. And so we just don't, even for anything that the supervisor doesn't need to access, we do all the course material and learning objectives and all of that stuff is in Canvas, not in Simplicity. For some of the FERPA reasons that you mentioned, the evaluations I'm okay with because I think the career services advisor should see that, but reflections and stuff, I'm not so sure that needs to be in a place where a lot of people can see it.
You mentioned this, I apologize, but do the MOUs get put in?
The MOUs are not here either. They're part of my learning objectives form. And so they sign that and submit them on Canvas. When our placements initially sign up, we actually have a separate system. I actually stopped getting them to sign up in Simplicity because that got too complicated. So I actually have a separate, just a simpler web form where they sign up and they type their name as a signature on an agreement. But then each semester that a student's at a placement, they actually sign, their direct supervisor signs a form acknowledging their responsibilities, and that's sort of the MOU. And so that gets turned in on the end.
Sorry, can you be specific?
Yeah, time. Oh, okay.
Sorry, what's the cost, like if you're piggybacking 2 hours off of career services, what's the cost of your externship program for this, for the experiential learning module?
Zero.
It's free.
Yeah. It's free. It's just a free add-on.
Can I say that is not entirely true?
Oh.
Okay, so your Simplicity license gives you only so many full access administrators, right? So if you need to add more full access administrators, which is what you need if you want you as externship faculty and, for instance, all your other faculty members who do externships, your license fees will go up.
Mm-hmm. But if I already have, we already do postings, so I already have, so I'm an administrator, so.
Yeah, so then all you have to do is ask them to turn on the experiential learning module. And actually, you know, our career services, we used to send them money just to defray the administrative hassle of working with Simplicity. But now our law school has decided that this is actually a system that a lot of different units within the law school actually use to pull information. And so they've put it into the general budget for, you know, technology. And so our career services office is not even paying for it out of their budget anymore. And so it's a little less. That's a way to address, by the way, like tension with the career services office, is to put it into the general budget.
Sarah,
yeah. All right, so we can answer more questions later. Tech was the other thing that I was going to show you, and that's our timekeeper. So.
Let me just say that we actually also consider simplicity, and as my career services folks like to call it, complexity, and decided against it for a bunch of reasons. When I got to Brooklyn with a program that has between 400 and 500 students a year in the program, 4 years ago when I got there, it was, again, mostly on paper. We used Blackboard for our course websites, and folks were submitting timesheets to the Blackboard integrated Dropbox, and then each seminar professor or faculty assistant would go into the Dropbox, into the course, into the Dropbox, and print out each student's timesheet in order to tally them and make sure they're working the proper hours and review them for substantive reasons. It was a mess. We eventually designed our own internal time log that was sort of based on a Clio type functionality. It didn't work either. We were overwhelmed by the paperwork requirements of the new 304C, getting all the memorandums of understanding. Everything was done by email. Email the form, download the form, fill out the form, scan it, email it back. This was as recently as like 2 years ago. So we started looking for alternatives. We decided against simplicity for a bunch of reasons, some of which are just very unique to Brooklyn Law School and have to do with how our career services sort of likes to manage things. And they are my really strong allies, and I did not want to step on any toes. And so I deferred to them about not using the Simplicity externship module. So I really don't have any personal experience with it. I was talking to folks at Denver, and they had adopted CORE, and they loved it. And they have a huge program like mine, and they were really encouraging about trying out CORE. And so we decided to give it a shot. And here are some of their features that, in general terms, I think advise them for a big program like Brooklyn's. First of all, it was designed ground up specifically for externships. Customizable, and the way the deal works now, included unlimited tech support. So at the beginning, they spent literally hours and hours with me customizing the website for Brooklyn Law School. They did multiple trainings for me, other members of the faculty, members of career services, the staff, and I am on the phone with them constantly. We have a weekly call set up every week just to review stuff. Often we cancel it because we're on the phone with them all the time, and they are just there at the drop of a hat to answer our questions. So CORE has an embedded customizable form that generates sortable data and simplifies matching. If you want to do the application enrollment process on CORE, we actually don't use that for a bunch of reasons. Our school encourages a highly entrepreneurial attitude amongst our students in terms of externships. It's part of the culture of the school. Students go out and find their own externships. We have a massive Simplicity site that lists literally hundreds of externship opportunities side by side with paying opportunities during school and postgraduate. And students can search there and make a decision, do I want to do an externship, do I want to do something paid? Or they can go out into the really vibrant New York City legal community and find their own placements. And so we decided what we would do is not use the embedded or application process. We don't do matching, and we didn't want to sort of limit when students are in the search that they, if they did that search within CORE, they would only be looking at approved paid placements, and it, unpaid placements, rather. And so it didn't sort of make sense to use that CORE feature, but the CORE will be happy to explain it to you if you want to talk to them about it. The CORE setup allows you to have students submit everything that you wouldn't run into sort of FERPA problems about. Right, so they could also submit essay reflective essays and stuff, but I don't have them do that for the reasons we've all been discussing. But they could submit their learning plan, their hour tracking, their self-assessments, their evaluations, the memorandum of understanding. And then on the back end, CORE has a reporting function, which just basically any information that's in there, you can massage and generate all sorts of reports that facilitate cross-sectional analytics and program assessment, right? So the students, what are the pros from the perspective of each person who interacts with CORE? For the students, it's a comprehensive platform for researching, applying, matching, tracking externship placements, including historical data. So what we do use CORE for is that once a placement is in the system, from now and then, you know, forever into the future, any placement that's in the system because a student once worked there is now part of our historical research data, and students can go and research placements. So they can also do research on Simplicity, and those same placements will show up on Simplicity, as well as additional ones who have yet to ever post a Brooklyn Law School student. But the CORE research data is much richer, has much more detail in it. And they also apply online, they to be actually enrolled in an externship program, and they can also see a history of their own externship participation. We allow students to do up to 3 credit-bearing externships during law school. So they can see all the externships they've ever done, and all the information is, that historical data is there and remains there for 5 years after they graduate. From the supervisor's perspective, it's, again, it's just sort of one-click participation. Now, whenever a student submits a time record, it automatically generates an email to the supervisor. The email has in the body of it the time record, at the bottom of the other, and at the bottom, the button at the bottom that says click to confirm. And it's as easy as that. Evaluations are all handled digitally. You have bulk email at the point in time in which you want supervisors to evaluate their students. The evaluation shows up as a link within the email. They don't have to log into their account. They fill out the evaluation. They submit. Done. From my perspective, everything is there. Wherever I am in the world, I can log on to CORE and handle whatever comes up with my students and see exactly what they're up to. So really simplifies communications. I think the best thing to do, though, here is, let me just go through the cons, because this, I just want to say, it may make more sense for large programs. They gave us a really sweet introductory pricing, and they usually price by the students, so obviously the cost would be lower for a smaller program. But even so, it's not the cheapest thing. It worked for us, because I was at the breaking point. And I was going to my administration, and I was asking for another headcount. I was asking for somebody who would be my non-faculty associate director or another assistant. I was just drowning. And that, in New York City, is, you know, 6 figures when you add in salary and benefits, right? So that was a 6-figure annual number. And CORE is a very, very low 5-figure annual number. So they had no problem when I said, okay, if you're not going to give me that, you have to give me this. So also, there's a significant learning curve. I mean, last summer, which was the summer that we built the ALP program and launched it for to begin fall 2017, I mean, that was my summer. I had to dedicate months to get myself up to speed and to train everybody and to customize the program. Also, there's a little bit of clunkiness, by no means the degree to which people have told me that Simplicity is clunky, but it was founded in the world of pharmaceutical and medical training, which, by the way, just goes to show you how far behind externships are. Law school is, not externships, but law school is in terms of valuing practical training, right? As somebody mentioned at the first plenary, every profession has practical training, so much so that for years, the pharmaceutical industry has been using CORE to cycle their students through placements. And some of the CORE terminology is a little clunky and they can't really change it. And so I have to sort of explain to my students that preceptor means mentor attorney. you can get by that. So let's do a demo. And I'm going to do just a few things. This is my entry page, right? You can see that CORE customized it. It's a Brooklyn Law School look on there. And so what I'm going to do is I actually asked a student for permission to use her file. But even so, I didn't want to use her name, so I changed her name. I went in and changed her student information to Jane Doe. Okay, so here we go. Oh, didn't even change it. Whatever, she gave me permission to use her file. So I just want to show you, so this is what I see, right? So this is the file of a student who has now done two, she did an externship in the fall. It's one of the reasons I chose this file, because I wanted to show historical data. I obviously don't have historical data earlier than this. So many students in the system have done multiple externships, but since they've only done one since we implemented CORE, you can only see that one. But over time, obviously, this is going to populate, right? So here I have the history of her externships. You can see that there's a custom field that I set up that shows which seminar she's assigned to. She's one of my students. She was assigned to my seminar this semester. So here are her current mentor attorneys. I can click into that mentor attorney's information anytime. So now I'm in the Legal Aid Society outward-facing account page. At the very beginning, we had to send an email to the entire world of people who had ever hosted Brooklyn Law School externs, talking over 1,000 people, and ask them to fill out mentor attorney information. And I'd say about 50 of them did that. Yeah. And then as they're actually now in the new CORE era, hosting Brooklyn Law School students, we are forcing them to fill out the information. So you will see here, if you go, I'm in the mentor attorney schedule, you see here that this is a popular placement. And these are all the students who historically, here's the spring students, up here are the fall students. I will have a list, one-stop shopping, of every student they've ever taken. You can also see that I can click, everything is clickable. Everywhere you see the little fist show up, I can click and see for every student what the mentor attorney said about the student, what the student said about the mentor attorney. I can go and read their final evaluations, right? So I can go back, so let's go back to the student I was just, where is it? Okay, let's go back to Jane Doe. Let's log in as that student. Log in as student. So now, this is just to show you, this is the student's outward facing page. So this is one of the efficiencies of the system, which is that I can change this message and drop the hat. I won't show you now, but on my outward facing page, there's a customization page, and anytime I want, I can go in and change this message so that when students log into CORE, they can see the most updated information that I want to give them. I could also post on students' homepage, as well as on the mentor attorney's homepage, whatever documents I want them to see first. Students go into the document library and see everything. You can see how I post a lot of information on the document library, including the syllabus for every one of the various seminars that they can opt for. But on the home-facing page, I just have a few sort of key stuff that I want them to be aware of.
Do you have any questions? I saw MOV is on there. Is that a form, or is that a Word doc that they post?
Okay, so the MOU is in the document library just so that they know what it looks like, because they cannot see their MOU until they are actually enrolled. this student is enrolled, and what this student would have seen was to go to the requirements, that's again, a pharmacy industry term that couldn't be changed, but it's all explained. If you go to home, there's actually one of the first things they see is BLS student introduction to Corey LMS, which is a very basic PowerPoint that tells them a lot of this stuff. But they go to requirements, and this would have said add MOU. They would open up the MOU, they would read it. Okay, so they would read the MOU, input their start and end date, read all the provisions of the MOU, and sign it by typing their name. And then the mentor attorney would get a message that says, now it's your turn. And the mentor attorney's MOU actually has a box in the bottom to address a problem that we heard from in a couple of sessions, which is what if they don't want to sign it, or if they don't like something like that. It actually has a box at the bottom that says, tell us any provision that you need us to strike or add, write it in here and sign it. And I, then when they've done that, I review that and make sure it's not like totally crazy. And I have no, everybody signs it now. They could just write in, we do not agree to this, you know, number three, whatever it, what it is, and I, or we only agree to this extent. And so it actually makes it very easy for them.
So they are doing that?
Yeah, they're doing, I think maybe, you know, 150 students a semester, I mean, three a semester, somebody's amended the MOU in some way.
And that's an electronic signature?
An electronic signature, exactly. Okay, so let's go to, back to me. I'm returning to my account right now. And let's just go to reports. Let's go to my efficiencies here. So here's student requirements. Let's go to mentor attorney requirements and memoranda of understanding, right? So I want to know by the second week of the semester how many mentor attorneys have done their part in signing their MOU. And so I can generate a report. Go here, reporting suite. And I can generate a report under mentor attorneys, requirements, mentor attorney requirements. I can run this report. And I will do it for, let's say, let's do it for the spring civil practice. And let's see, everybody who's completed, well, let's just do it for everybody. Run report. I have to do individual. There's a lot to learn in this, I have to admit. Check. Okay. There you go. So this is everybody who has signed an MOU. It tells me where they are. I can figure out who hasn't signed. Let me just move a little faster. I just put that way. So they also, there's an evaluation form that I'll show you in a minute. The great thing about the evaluation form is it's totally customizable. I can put anything in either student or mentor attorney evaluation that I can generate reports. So for instance, students are evaluating their placements based on whether they are, based on the kind of work that they're doing. And here, so let's go to the reporting suite. Oh, here, okay, let's do student hours. This is a good one, too. Student hours tracking. Okay, so suppose you're a seminar professor in my program, and you want to see your students' hours, and you want to see it in a sort of efficient way. Let's pick Camille, run the report. This is all her students' hours. How many hours they've logged to date. You can view a particular student and see, based on the way that we ask them to record their hours, they have to do an hours description, they have to click the kind of lawyering tasks that they participated in, they have to describe what they did. Okay, and let's do one more thing. Let's do evaluations. Yeah. Okay, so let me just
tell you that there's so many features here. I am happy to spend time with anybody. I have my laptop. We can spend time later looking at the various features and move on to G-Suite.
I don't want to follow that. This is the DIY, do-it-yourself of options. This is one, so G is for Google, if you couldn't figure that out. I obviously assume that you're somewhat familiar with Google, and they just keep adding features, and this is what I use it for. I get my students registered with my program, and I use it to track what they're doing a bit. I use it for time entry, for the students to enter their time and me to check up on them. I do midterm and final evals. I wrote site visits there. Just last year, the Greater Los Angeles Consortium on Externships started using this. I set something up where you go out on a site visit and you want to write your little report, you write it in the Google form, and then the rest of us at the other 8 or 9 schools can see, what's going on at that school. And so those are the four basic things. There are expanded uses that I haven't done yet, but I've been thinking about. So for example, I'll show you my time entries. I could put a little code on there, like the type of task, I think that's what Jody's had, and run reports about that later. Or I've set it up where my student and supervisor evals are asked, in most part, the same questions. So I can now compare how well the student thinks she performed to how well the supervisor performed and compare them directly. And then there's something called Google Hangouts, which I learned about recently, which if you want to do conversations with your students, small groups, you can do that way. I haven't done that one yet, though. And even more. Okay, so here's my pros and cons real quick. The pro is that it's free, and it's free and it's free. It is incredibly student-friendly. Google, the Google Suite has been used in education for a while. In Google terms, that probably means like a year and a half, but it feels like a long time. And my undergraduate campus uses it. They use it because high schools are using it. So when you're asking students to get on board, this is native to them. The setup is fairly easy. I spent a weekend trying to figure stuff out and playing around, not a semester. It's very flexible when you want to change. Mid-semester, I realized that I wanted to add one little line to my time entry that would allow students to get a copy back of what their time entry was, email to them, and I just do, and I did it. And I didn't have to call anybody and put in a request. And I work with my part, my share assistant very easily with it. I could either do it by sharing the documents and things with her, but what I actually did is I shared my password. So I created a Google account called Chapman Externships, and I have the login and she has the login, so the two of us together are Chapman Externships, and that way we both access the documents easily. The bad things, none of this fancy stuff that you just saw can I do. I'm not integrated with Simplicity or Career Development Office in any way. This is purely once the students show up at my door, stuff. You must be comfortable with, well, they wouldn't call it Excel. They call it Google Sheets, but it's spreadsheets. Man, there's a lot of spreadsheets. I've erased things on occasion. There's not really a backup. It's all in the cloud. I'll show you my workaround, but you have fat fingers. put your fingers on an exercise regimen or something. On occasion, I've erased things. There's no guy to call at the home office to ask what to do. There's tons of help. Online videos, there's this Chrome extension that you can get that I'll show you later. And then the security worries. When people hear the cloud, they get worried. And FERPA and whatever. I think it is as safe as anything is that we have in modern society. I don't think that the stuff that my students are using it for is a FERPA issue anyway, but there is a FERPA workaround, which is many of you, and you might not know if you are or not, but many of your schools are actually already Google email based. doesn't look like it, you still have your regular school address, but it's supported by Google. So actually, everything I'm doing, if I did it on my Chapman account instead, somehow, in some closet somewhere, there's a FERPA shield, and it's all compliant. Don't ask me how it works, but they said, they don't like that I do it my way, because the FERPA protections aren't on it. But for me, it's a little too late to switch over, switch back to theirs. And again, there's no grades on there. So I'm not worried. But anyway, pros and cons. So let's just demonstrate this. I want to show you what it looks like when a student registers. I've dumbed this down a bit. I stripped out some of the questions. My registration is pretty long. But they'll scroll down. You've all seen things like this. This is just a Google form when you've filled out questionnaire. So student's name, when they're going to register, for what semester. I need to know their GPA because the limits on the number of units they can take differs. Blah, blah, blah. So they go down and do all this stuff. This one isn't as exciting. Once they hit enter, somewhere down here. Well, it's an, oh, send, I'm sorry. Once they hit send, it's off and it comes to me. And I get my first spreadsheet. I blacked out students' last names. That's my way of not getting permission. So I get this giant spreadsheet, and now I know. The timestamp I don't care about, but when are they wanting to enter? What's their name? What's their class? What's their GPA? I scroll across, and I have all this information. This is the master receptacle of everything I have. If I erase something from this accidentally, and I have, it's trouble. The student will say, comes to week three and said, I haven't gotten any of the externship emails, what's up? And I realize they got erased and I don't know who they are. So for that reason, and also for the reason that I have the same form, I use it every year. I don't change the form email address or what they have to type in to get there. This is just my receptacle. For when I have it populated for the semester, I actually cut and paste it over into something else so that I have a backup. And let me show you what that one would be. This is what I call it's the sheet tailor. I cut it way down. So here's my same people. I've hidden most of those boring forms. I have everybody for the semester, and then here's where I communicate with my assistants through this form. I then added a few columns, like, did they turn in their resume and transcript? What section are we putting them in? Did you get them registered? Because we have to then send this over to the registrar's office. What section are they in? Did you send the email? All this stuff. So, and here's the big one.
One question about that.
Yeah.
So the resumes and transcripts are being submitted in hard copy?
Yes. So this isn't, there's a certain extent where my fanciness wears off. And I have an assistant, and a student will email or send it in, and we just want it in the file. I mean, there's my MOUs, they're pieces of paper. I personally feel I want a supervisor with her pen to look at the section and use her pen to write her name. I feel like I'm getting their attention a little more.
But how many do you have again, Carol?
100 a semester. So, but I don't have the money. I mean, this is,
no,
yeah. Okay, scraps. I'm working with scraps. So I'll tell when my assistant pulls this up and sees that I wrote approved, she knows she's ready to go. She's going to go do her thing. If I say I'm waiting on some forms or they didn't give me my supervisor contact, I type that stuff in. And then she knows what to do from there. We are so tight, so I'm just going to keep going through. This is the fun one for me. This is the billable hours report. Every student gets a link and they use it all semester. I've actually had this more detailed in the past, but I've trimmed it down, but it's designed, my idea was it's going to look like a time slip, like what they use in practice. But I've simplified it. They give me their name, the date they worked, the total time, and they describe their activities, and they hit submit. The thing that I've added, if you add a section where they put in their own email address, they'll get a copy back. The downside of this, the way it's set up right now, is they enter their time, it goes to me, and they never see it again. And then, come April, they say, how many hours have I done? Have I finished yet? And I hate that. So now I'm making sure they get copies. So it's a learning process. As I go, I discover new tricks that I didn't realize I could do, and I add them in. This is what their spreadsheet will look like when it comes to me. Now, that's a mess, right? what I'll do is every week or two, I'll log on and I'll see who's been doing what since. So I subbed out their names again so I could keep this up. And I just see, I don't really care what order it's in. You'll see I put it in alphabetical order for this, but I continue to do more research on controlled substance laws, blah, 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 and I'll read it, that's fine. What I'll do though, if I wanna see how my students, particular students doing, is I'll sort it by last name, and then here's my little trick. If I just highlight their hours, and you go down here, if you can see, here's the sum. This person has 24 hours so far. Person F, I used to think I had to do some fancy formula and enter something. This person is 39. So it's a tiny bit of clicking on my part, but it is light years ahead of hard copy sheets, which is what I graduated from with this. Let me show you the last thing that I absolutely love. Google does this for me. I don't even have to ask. So I did my, this is for my supervisor's final review. I get 100 of them in, if I'm lucky. Usually I get 80, and then I'm making phone calls. And I asked, how would you rate the students' legal skills at the end of the externship? And this is what I get. So of all my students, most of them are good and excellent. And then I feel very good, and I go home and sleep well. Here's another one. Which skills do the students improve most? And I see that, legal knowledge, legal analysis, writing, research, wow, aren't my students doing well? And I feel good. And this is something I can show to my dean and be proud of. Yes.
How are you sending the eval to the supervising attorney? Is it an email?
It's a Google form.
You're sending them an email, so a link?
Yes. Well, actually, I don't do it. I tell my students, time to send your supervisor the link. So the other thing I've done is outsourced a bit. The students are in charge of giving their supervisors the link that I've already published.
We do that too. We have a lot of federal placements that they can't do Google stuff if they're on their computers.
I've had one or two, not federal, and I have my old forms as backup.
Yeah, so you sent them the PDF.
We have 5 minutes left, so questions for me or for everybody? I can talk more? No, that's all. I move through.
Sorry, this is a general question to the room. I'm getting some pressure to use Salesforce. Is anybody in the room using Salesforce? That's my answer. Thank you.
You took an empirical survey. Laura, nobody in the room in the morning uses it.
Laura, yes. I'm pretty sure Sue does. So as of June last year when we were talking,
okay.
I'm pretty sure Sue.
What are some things?
Messed up here again.
We took the poll earlier and a lot of you answered other. Unless the answer is none. What are some of the names that you all use?
Actually, I have a question.
Shout them out.
You had a pro cons line for publicity.
Huh?
Can you throw that up?
Oh, yeah. Pro cons. The pros and cons.
Oh,
these slides are beyond the, you know.
Yeah, she just had it up, but she doesn't have time. Can you just put it up just so I can?
I just did.
Okay.
Yep.
Oh, there it is. Thank you.
Yeah.
What have you mentioned, too?
Yes. So, timekeeping. I use Tick, which is, this is what their time card looks like. I can actually look at any of my students here and edit their time cards. I set them up as, So I set them up as, these are the last three digits of their student ID number. That's just so that you can give them a budget, but you don't have to do that. You can have a single project and it's free. Or it's like $20 a month if you have up to 10 projects, which is all of our different sections of courses. And this is, you can see how many hours they have, you can run reports. It's very easy to use from their end, and it has a little timer. And so it looks a lot like it would look in practice. The tech support guy is actually a UGA law graduate, and he knew exactly what I was talking about when I called him and asked him how to use this for externships. And I've found it to be very, it is a pain, well not a pain, it's actually not that bad to set up, but you have to set, you know, each student up manually. There's not a bulk import, but once you get them set up, I've found that it's pretty straightforward to use. So if anybody has any questions about, you know, how I set this up, actually the tech support guy can help you, but I can also help you with that.
The other thing is, you know, with CORE, one thing I noticed is the difference is that
you bulk import the student, every student in the school, whether they ever have done an extra trip or ever will do an extra trip, has a four account from the minute they matriculate. And you never have to import anything again. And it's all automatically generated. So just thinking about how much time I have put in from the front end to create four, but that's it. You never have to do it again any semester. It's all positive. It's all there.
So given yesterday's discussion, it sounds like we may have a 10-year document retention policy coming. Any of your programs, do you like that? It's going to work in the system you're using?
Core, definitely.
Well, Google, theoretically.
But then my Google Drive gets crazy, so after the year's over, I download everything and clear it out.
Download it where?
To my computer.
Our internal servers are full, so we're using Google Drive to supplement our internal stuff.
We use Box. The university uses Box, not Dropbox, but Box, which is FERPA compliant, and it's a shared space. And so I do, have I been good about downloading reports and stuff? Probably not, but now I'll go back and do that. I have been assuming that I have to retain records for a year after the student has graduated, based on the other ABA rule. I would just download them to Box.
Your support on there.
Yeah, you don't have to keep everything for 10 years.
No.
No. No. Yeah. Right. Other question.
So is this free, did you say?
TIG is free if you don't try to set up different classes and different projects. So if you have a single project, then you can put all of your students into that, and it's free.
So no matter the number of students.
No matter the number of students, and that's what's unique about this versus most and almost any other web-based timekeeping system is it usually is per user charge. And this is free it's a per project charge, and one project is free. 10 projects is $20 a month, and then it goes up from there.
How do you get the supervisor sign off on?
I don't do supervisor sign off.
Really?
Yeah. I would be spending all my time chasing them.
Can I add to that? I don't either. I'm not able to, but I added into my midterm and final review, is a student meeting their hours?
I do the same. I have a certificate of completion of hours at the end of the semester that the student has to take to the supervisor and have them sign to confirm that they did everything they said they did.
They can actually print, so the student, some placements actually want the hours, so they can actually run a report and give that to their supervisor. But the supervisors, most of them tell me, like if they don't have to track it for any reason, most of the supervisors will tell me, I don't know, I trust them to sort of, keep their time and report that to you, but I'm not keeping track of it.
Right. We have issues sometimes where it's important for the supervisor to know what the student has been doing because we feel they're not getting quality assignments, or the supervisor gets upset because the student spent 20 hours on a research memo when they wanted a quick answer. So we find that having them submit, we make them enter timesheets every week, submit, email goes to the supervisor has to confirm, which means essentially they have the opportunity to read the timesheet, but whether they did or not, they have to go scroll down and email that the time information is in the email, not the attachment, and click confirm at the bottom.
We have one last question from Laura.
I was just going to say, I make the students do it. Biweekly report and tell them you must have your supervisor review this before the deadline, and I won't look at it. I mean, it's a little clunky, but it's like, this is protecting the confidentiality and making sure your report is accurate. This is your obligation.
There is the ability to actually print out a weekly timesheet from the end, and they, so you could get them to bring that back, have it signed, but I just don't require them to do that. All right.
Thank you.